welcome to episode 9 of Sound of Spurs podcast. And we're very, very happy to be joined by an old friend of mine, actually, a guy that spent 5 years with the Spurs from 05 to 09 and still has a special place in the heart of many fans in Argentina and in San Antonio. And that is one Fabricio Raul Jesus Oberto.
Aren't you so impressed?
I looked you up on Google and Wikipedia because I didn't know anything about you.
I thought that you're going to give me the episode number 7, you know. Now I'm
we should
number.
Have.
Yes, yes. Yes. But, well, always a pleasure. I wonder if you still got all the recordings that we got in, you know, 05, 06. You might have all the recordings, right?
I have all of the great baskets that Fabricio Oberto scored during that time, but I don't know if I have any of our interviews.
Well, the interviews at the end of the game, I remember sitting in the table over there and just with the fans chatting. And I don't know how was my English in that time, but in those days, but was fun just to receive all that love after a game. And, you know, most of the time when you do something right, you're going to be sitting in that chair next to you. So that was lucky for me.
I think one of those games was that 11 for 11 from the field game, Fabricio. I don't know if you remember that, but I do pretty well.
And of course,
most of them were layups and short shots right around the rim. It's not like you're taking a lot of threes,
I'm going to tell you, I got like 3 or 4 shots from outside of the paint. You know,
you did.
I was changing my shot when I got, and Chip was doing, you know, his magic on my free throw and everything. And the first year was like really hard. I tell you, I was like, please don't pass me the ball because I changed completely the way I was shooting. And that was weird in those. And that was the first year of the first game of the, maybe after the, no, before the championship. Mm-hmm. And I started, you know, getting that trust on my shot, on my game again. And was awesome. That game was so much fun, so much fun.
I don't think I'll ever forget your first preseason game. Correct me if I'm wrong, Fabricio, was in Miami.
Yes.
And you were up against Shaq, or at least one of the early preseason games your first year. And I remember talking to you after the game. You go, there's nobody in Europe that's like that, right? What about that adjustment play? Your
I got
first
a story
game?
of that night.
Please do. Please share. Know?
So a couple of years ago, we are in a dinner and Pop is over there and there is the other coaches. And they start telling me that that was like a, you know, okay, let's, you know, put Fab without help against Shaq. Just to, you know, like a baptism, you know, NBA. So, and I remember that, you know, before the game talk, you know, Fab, you're going to go 1-on-1, no help. And I remember like, no help? What? It was hilarious, and that's the way, and you know, all the years and the family and the culture of the Spurs, how they take each person so specially and so important for you know, for the organization, for the chemistry of the team. It's unbelievable.
You know, we kind of jumped right into this, and I wanted to get more into your background, but we'll do that in a minute. But since we're on this topic, Manu posted something the other day about a funny moment with Pop, and it was when he grabbed an offensive rebound late in the game, and I think the team had a 1-point lead, and he dribbled to the corner, and he faked a three as if he was going to take it with 24 seconds left in the shot clock, and Pop jumped higher than LeBron James, Manu said. So Manu had a way of kind of playing with Pop in a way, and I think maybe, and I might be wrong, but you international guys had a very unique relationship with Pop and maybe could kid with him a little bit.
Well, I never tried to do something like that adventurous, like Manu, you know, like he got another way and, you know, his game. I remember in a practice, I used to throw the, you know, the pick and rolls, the pass through my legs. And Bruce almost, you know, was like surprised, almost lose the ball. And so Pop stopped the practice, said, listen, all these international guys, they're going to go with crazy passes. So just be ready, expect the ball. And I did it in the game. And Bruce, you know, got the three on the corner and, you know, was that funny moments. I remember B. Cole as that I made one of the ugliest basket that he ever seen. That was, you know, he called a timeout for that. I love that moment and story from Pop. Like all the guys, he weighed like TD Manu, Tony, all the guys around him and say, well, Fab, that was the ugliest basket I ever seen. So thank you.
Hey, it went in, right? It counts. It's just like I always said, the most important offensive rebound in your career was game four against Cleveland in the 07 finals. And I don't know if you remember that stretch, but I think the Spurs had about three or four offensive rebounds in a row. And I know Cleveland was very, very frustrated because they couldn't get the defensive rebound. And you got a putback with about a minute to go that really ended up being the game winner of the ball game.
Yeah, I don't think like a Hollywood director or the best director that can relate for a movie or do a movie. Manu went off in the last 6-7 minutes, and I was lucky to get the rebound. So sometimes, you know, when they're trying to double, they start playing like that zone defense, kind of trying to cheat on the spacing. And I got a couple passes from Manu under the basket. So it was like playing in the national team. You know, I knew he was going to throw the pass. TD in that moment that I score, and he's coming and just yelling. That moment was unbelievable.
That must have been a special moment. Let's get back to your roots. Las Farias, yes, Argentina. You're born in the mid-70s. When did you discover basketball, and what kind of facilities were available for young players in a town like Las Farias, Argentina?
Well, the facilities were soccer fields. In Argentina, it's everything about soccer. And I started doing like some track and field, and I was the highest guy on the class. So most of the time, you know, if you're tall, you're gonna try to, you know, match with any sports. And I fell in love with basketball since when I was 7 years old. And from there until 38, that was my last game, I've been in love. And I never learned to play. You know, I still, like, if I would be back playing right now, would be like, oh, I still got to learn a bunch of things. But really fun. All my friends, you know, started like getting there. And in Argentina, it's crazy because in high school, like, okay, we're going to play soccer today. I was telling the coach, you know, like the teacher is like, well, we don't play basketball. Oh, we're going to play soccer. Okay, we play soccer. So always was that battle and trying to learn. And, you know, I was really contained, love by basketball. I mean, I love it, all the chemistry or the situations, you know, travel. And if your parents get a chance to, you know, take you to some game, because you start going different cities when you're small, and was like really fun.
You signed your first professional contract with Atenas, is that correct?
Yes, Atenas de Córdoba. I was playing already in another town, kind of getting my, you know, paying for tickets or some, you know, extra for the expenses that I was doing. So I played 2 years while I was doing high school and working in the morning. So it was like crazy traveling, trying to study on the bus. The bus take, you know, used to take like, well, still takes like 1.5 hours to do 90K, stopping everywhere, that bus, you know, those all buses, like they see something on the field and they're going to stop and see, okay, someone is going to ride the bus. So I did it for 2 years. And after I got the, you know, like a test and, you know, try out with Atenas, and, you know, I signed for my first year over there.
So that was actually professional basketball. I mean, you got paid to play. Was that in the Argentina League?
Yeah, Argentina League. Yes. I started being like a junior over there, you know, under 21 or under 22, I was signed. I played 4 years over there. And after, you know, I got the chance, when I started getting more minutes, I was playing. My goal in those days was playing in Atenas. Most of the national team, I mean, like 4 or 5 guys from the national team of Argentina were playing over there. One of my first idols, Milanesio, was playing there. So imagine, my second idol was Tony Kukoc. I couldn't play with him. I watched him when he was in Benetton in Italy or in the Bulls. But the other guy that I met when I was in year 96 was Tim Duncan. Since that moment, I started watching him. And after, I was lucky enough to play with him, and after, be riding bikes with him. So
Well, I've always heard that Tim was a great teammate. You know, once he trusted you and got to know you a little bit, knew that you had some game. You know, Manu talked about that same thing, earning Tim's trust. Tony talks about the same deal. It takes a little while to earn his trust, but once you do and he's got you in his corner, he'll take care of you, right?
Yeah, the first year, most of the guys, and I think Pop told me, like, oh, don't worry if Tim doesn't talk to you in the first year. You know, I was like already I played against him internationally. So we got like a kind of, you know, offense. He was, you know, trying to play defense on him, trying to use some tricks in international. Like he really loves to play in FIBA. And, you know, trying to get him in foul trouble or, you know, messing with him. There is no other way that you can guard TD. You got to try to mess or foul or take it to the FIBA rules. And from that moment, every time, even my first year, you know, I was 30. I was the oldest rookie ever.
It's true.
And you got to get the donuts. So they were like two boxes from one store and another box that you got to bring from another store that is for TD. So after 20 games, you know, I say, okay, we get in a relation. I went to TD and said, hey, TD, can we manage just to have these two or three boxes from this store? And he looked at me and said, no, I like the other ones. But no chance to pick.
Just to make it harder for you, just because you had to take an extra stop and get more donuts.
Yes, I got to go to, you know, like 5-10 minutes. And well, I did it. I was a rookie all the way. And I thought that you're going to be like, yeah, Fab, no worries. No, I like the other ones. But the funny thing, I never see him eating one.
No, of course not. He probably didn't eat them. He was just giving you a hard time.
For sure. 100%.
It's like I read a story about Michael Jordan one time. You know, he used to play for big, big money on the card games up front. And one time he decided to go in the back where the guys were playing for $2 a hand. And Will Perdue said, well, why are you coming back here to play for $2 a hand? He goes, because I want your $2. I want your money. So Tim wanted to make sure that you stopped and got those donuts, whether he ate them or not, probably, Fab, right?
Yes, yes, for sure. But that was a great moment and really – since the signing with the Spurs, they made me feel that I got already like 10 years on my backpack, you know, playing NBA. It was unbelievable, the respect, how much they knew about my game. And, you know, I got the best advertiser, Manu, you know, he's going to tell, you know, whatever they need. But besides that, you know, when you get in the organization and the value, and they make you feel like really important. Like today, I mean, every day, just doing the podcast or doing anything with the Spurs is like a blessing, really honor for me.
I wanted to talk to you a little bit more about your broadcasting career a little bit later on. We still have so much ground to cover with your playing career. You mentioned Manu, of course, and that was your entry to the Spurs. He was bragging on you to the coaches. But you also knew that you would have a specific role with the team. Was that pretty much spelled out in the very beginning? Because, you know, you weren't going to come in and be a guy that's going to score 25 points. They knew that and you knew that, but you had a very important specific role in the ball club. What about that role and how you fit that role during that period of time?
Well, as soon as I got the chance, I don't know if you heard this story, but 24 hours later, before my contract with the Spurs, I got another, you know, an offer from the Grizzlies. So I told my agent, well, I'm going to wait tomorrow, like right now, tomorrow noon, I tell you and we sign. And, you know, it was the fax machine. I got to sign the pre-con. And we can put a picture so the kids or the young people realize what it is. And my agent is like, hey, you've been waiting so much time for this. What are you going to wait? Well, I want to wait 24 hours. So next day, we're going to one of the first checkup of my daughter, Julia. And we are getting into the doctor office. And I see a phone call, and it's unknown. And, well, I answer, it's my agent. So, listen, we got an offer from the Spurs. I say, I signed there. Done deal. I mean, it's done. I mean, I get so excited, like, right now. You say, well, but this is going to be different. No, I don't care. I've been watching Tim Duncan. I know all the sets that they play. Manu is there, all the guys. I want to play there. So that was the story. And 30 minutes later of that call, I receive another unknown call, and it's Pablo telling me, welcome to the Spurs.
Right.
So imagine, I was like floating. I don't know if I got my daughter. My daughter was a month old. The doctor couldn't understand why I was like flashing, like flying in that room. It was unbelievable.
There were so many things going on for you at the same time. So you had all these emotions. And then was there a certain fear about English? Because you mentioned the fact that your English wasn't as good as it is now.
I've been studying all my since you know, the high school, because it's something that I can't control. You know, playing good or scoring or making a lot of shots, I mean, you're going to practice, but depend on different situation, the game that the team is playing for you. And you were asking me about that rule. When I signed for the Spurs, my only goal was don't be a bother or a thing that caused, you know, no chemistry on the court. Yes. You know, like, I imagined myself being in the corner and say, okay, here I'm not in the way of anybody. You know, that was my rule to play. And trying to get all the fouls, you know, just being around TD or any of the players. I knew that Manu, TD, and Tony got to be on the court. So if I'm close to them, and if you look some games, I'm going to raise really quick my hand and you're going to get the foul. Because, you know, it's like 21-7-7, okay. And I knew the rules. I knew I already got three fouls before the game start. And I knew it. I mean, I would be like really, really bad if I don't know those rules. You know, it's not like concern. I don't got to feel like hurt, my feelings hurt or something. It's the way it is.
But the unique thing about that whole team is everybody, and we talked about roles before, but some guys had to sacrifice certain things. Manu, of course, came off the bench. Mm-hmm. A lot of other stars in the league wouldn't have wanted to come off the bench. They wouldn't be in the starting lineup. Mm-hmm. But Manu understood his role and the best value he had for the team. And it seemed to me like a lot of guys did that. There you go. See? It's a Ginobili thing. But I do understand. We the people that are watching this podcast do understand.
Right? Oh, yes.
Well, the first time I saw Manu play was in the World Championships in 2002 in Indianapolis.
Yep.
And you guys almost beat Serbia, which I think was Yugoslavia at the time.
Yes, sir.
And that's, I think, the way, and of course, Manu had already been drafted by the Spurs. He was already kind of in the fold, although he hadn't come over yet.
Yep.
But I think that was the first time people realized A, how good Manu was, and B, how good you guys were, the Argentina team.
And that's the right fit, no? When the team is the most important thing, and you know the main guys can preach, can lead to the other players. That what happened. That is the closest experience that I ever have with the team, the Spurs, you know, as a national team, because you got TD, that's going to show the way, Tony, Manu, those three guys, plus Pap, plus the organization, they're going to take you to that road that you got to understand the meaning of the team, how you put your talent, you know, in favor or to make whatever happens, but for the team. And that's, you were talking, Manu coming from the bench, you know, those guys, if you hit that game that you were mentioning, the 11 from 11, I mean, I think TD or Brand or Manu, Tony, they were more happy than me. I mean, it's like that feeling, like go back and forth of the energy that you can build. And if not, you got to pick another, you know, single sport if you can adapt to those rules.
Sure. We're like pickleball. You and I are pickleball buddies.
Yes.
It's impossible to lob over Fabricio Oberto at the net, by the way, in pickleball, just so you know. He's got the long reach and he's 6'10". The adjustment from the NBA or to the NBA from Europe, of course, you had played overseas and you played for mm-hmm. some pretty good teams, Talsoramico in Spain, Olympiacos, obviously, in Greece. So these are legendary programs are over in Europe. You come over to a program that's already established with the Spurs. What was the biggest adjustment for you, Fab, in terms of going to the NBA, this huge league that covers the entire continent with 30 teams?
Well, just the main thing, how can I earn my spot and be useful for the team? Just put whatever. If I got to, you know, take fouls, play defense, run the floor or whatever. I knew that there is like every night, there is a big challenge. Like you got to guard Shaq, Yao, Howard, Dirk. Every night was like that. So I was like really excited and motivated for that reason. And just trying to help the team. And when you go, I mean, I got these three guys on the team, like, okay, they're going to score and I got to be helping if they help too much. So you remember the Western Finals against Utah, 07. So they start helping from my guy. So I was ready. I knew perfect all the spots where I'm going to play under the basket, trying to hide, trying to see where they're going to try to sneak and try to play better D on TD. And TD, I knew the guys, they're going to pass me the ball. So that was just being ready is the main thing that gets you the spot in the league.
It seems like a small skill, but you had good hands. And that really helped you because as you're roaming the baseline and those guys are occupying defenders, you were able to get some easy buckets inside, weren't you?
One time I got signed by the Wizards, so one of the players told me, why are you shooting? I mean, you practice every day, like, you know, hooping about around the basket, hooks, running hooks, layups every day, but you just take like two or three shots in the game. And I said, well, I got to be like ready because if I get three shots, maybe I won't get any more. So I got to score those three. That was my idea, you know, trying to just be efficient as I can be.
Of course, you were a teammate with Manu on the Argentina national team, a team that is absolutely legendary in FIBA. And by the way, congratulations, because in 2019, just a few years ago, you were inducted into the FIBA Hall of Fame. And that's probably very, very special for you and to be part of that whole generation of great basketball players in Argentina.
Yes, was a big honor. You know, the same night was inducted with Alonso Mourning, Piculín Ortiz from Puerto Rico. I don't know if there is another player I took so many moves that I copy him. I mean, like, copycat all the moves, you know, how. And I told the story, like, hey, I used to watch all your videos to see all your moves, you know, footwork. And well, I was in the Hall of Fame inducted the same year that like he was getting inducted. So it was like a really big honor for me being with those guys. Alonso Mourning, you know, we were talking and he told me, oh, you used to, we got a good fights, and you know, when we play in NBA or, and that recognition is like, I never score like, you know, every game or, but when you get that feeling for another, you know, player, it's like really good, really good. When they recognize that, I mean, you did good things. I don't know, maybe exceptional, like, you know, scoring 80 points, but there's so many things that you can do to impact the game.
You had so many cool teammates, and obviously Manu and you were very close, but who were your other favorite teammates? Who were the guys that you used to spend time with off the floor maybe during your period of time with the Spurs?
Well, I got great stories, and I was really fun of most of them. I didn't tell them.
Not Matt Bonner.
No, Matt, every day that I see or share any moment, I get surprised. It's like the guy who's going to overwhelm, like, doing like a magic or story or some crazy comments, some nerd culture. Unbelievable. So much fun. Brent is, you know, another guy that coming from the music, loving the Seattle scene, grunge bands. You know, we got so much connection over there and talking. And most of the time with all these guys, we don't talk about basketball. We just talk about different topics. And I think is when you start getting the connection. I don't know, playing with Robert Horry, Nick Van Exel. You know, I used to, you know, if I was practicing or shooting with Lev, I was going to call like Nick Van Exel and, you know, teardrop or something. And all of a sudden I'm playing with him. So unrealistic, man.
Yeah, good teammates. Hey, this reminds me of a story. I was interviewing you before a game in Utah one time, and I was asking you about how fans are rowdy in certain arenas. And Utah is known to be kind of a tough crowd. And you just started laughing. And you said, this is nothing compared to playing in Greece. Share just a story or two about the crazy fans in Greece when you were playing over there.
Well, really fun. I love that energy on the arenas. You know, just people throwing the car keys or the house keys, you know, they're just throwing it. You can see in the control table like a mountain of keys and different phones. You remember the old brand that with the little cover?
Sure.
You know, that was like almost a brick. When you see like, you know, rotten eggs, oh my God, it was like really fun, really fun. Playing with that, you know, still yesterday I was talking with Tarlac, that I play over there in Greece after we crossed path when he was playing with the Bulls. But great experience, just, you know, trying to adapt, trying to see when they, maybe you were running a fast break and you're going to see a firework, you know, just landing and blowing in the middle of the
like a firecracker or
yes.
A cherry
oh,
pie.
No, one yes, of those yes, it was like.
Wow.
Big ones, but amazing experience also in Spain, you know, the respect. And that was my first year in Greece. I always said like Olympiakos fan, you know, I wish I could be like more mature to show more of my game. Always thankful, always texting me or, you know, sending social media messages. Unbelievable. We were talking about great teammates. Well, I got to mention like Michael Finley, Bruce, you know, all those guys. My God, this is long. Jack Bond, all the list of those guys. Unbelievable. I mean, I'm going to be short with all the names.
Yeah, but you don't want to leave anybody out. But so many of these guys have gone on to other organizations. I saw Jacques, of course, the other night in Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. Thiago Splitter is an assistant coach. Sean Marks is the general manager. So Sean. There's a lot of connections. Yeah. You mentioned music earlier. I just want to touch on that before we exit here. We've got a few more minutes with Fabricio Oberto, Sound of Spurs podcast presented by HEB. You have a man cave in your house, I understand, and you have some guitars. Your relationship with music, just kind of bring us up to date with what you're doing with your music.
Yes, well, now that I moved to Texas, it's like the band, you know, kind of pause right now, but for sure always trying to learn different instruments or, you know, keep playing guitar. I got the same feeling. Like, I mean, you travel with the guitar and maybe you're still doing it. You're still doing
it. A little bit here and there. Yeah.
But, you know, when you got that connection and you can play and start doing some own stuff, it's really fun. I love to write. I love to read a lot. And that's the main thing, like, concern right now. Hopefully, soon enough, I'm going to be playing in a band. Still crazy in love with learning about the boys and singing. I might need a couple years more to be like the level that I want to be, but it's completely different role than being setting screens and, you know, passing the ball, like being a lead singer. You know that.
Yeah, absolutely. And now it's you sing in English and in Spanish?
Try to.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, that's well because, you know, sometimes I don't know if your musical mind is in English or in Spanish right now, and maybe
no,
both.
No, I mean, both. I try to be both. I got songs that I wrote in English. Maybe I sing in Spanish. That's the way that you got to be creative. But we got to find some jam session. You're really like expert level.
I write more than I play. I think you're a better player than I am, but I like
no,
I
no,
like
no,
the
no,
right
no.
One.
That for I sure. Like maybe we can write something, a couple of songs.
Okay, we'll write a couple of tunes together. That's a deal. Are any of your music available? Can someone go on Spotify and hear some Fabricio Oberto or no?
Well, New Indians still on Spotify. We haven't played together the last 2 years, but the music stayed there.
Okay.
And hopefully next 2023 we're gonna start jamming, and you know, the technology also got much better that you can, you know, through the, like we're doing right now, you can play now, you got like musician bands connected and no delays. So hopefully we're going to start doing something when I get back. And they planning to maybe come at some point. So we will see. We will see what happens with the music.
Well, we'll keep us posted for sure. Before we let you go, your broadcasting career is going very well. You're doing a lot of stuff internationally. And you're working with my good buddy, Publio Paul Castro, doing some Spurs games in Spanish.
Yes, Saturday. Well, we're gonna start doing, you know, in Spanish. It's a great experience. And also, you can see the team relate also for you guys. I mean, so many guys doing it and not afraid to, you know, color analyst add for the broadcast and try different things. Really fun. I enjoy it and also learning a lot. I mean, you guys are pro, so I get to take advantage of that.
Fabricio, at the end of your career, you had a heart issue, atrial fibrillation. How is that going along? How are you feeling these days? You look great.
Yeah, well, thank you. So far, great. All the test holters that I'm doing and, you know, keeping in touch with the doctors. Riding a lot, cycling with Manu and TD, all the guys over there with the group. It's unbelievable. So if I can do that with those crazy guys that they, you know, the rhythm, I always tell this kind of joke, but it's not so far from the reality. It's like when we start riding, it's like we stole the bikes. That's the speed that we're trying to maintain. It's crazy.
Well, it's so good that you were able to stay in touch with those guys. I'm so happy that you're still in San Antonio and doing all your stuff, your music, your broadcasting. It's been a lot of fun to cover your career. Fabricio Oberto, a member of the FIBA Hall of Fame, NBA champion, gold medal winner, broadcaster, singer-songwriter, a little bit of everything, truly a man of the world. This podcast is presented by HEB, Sound of Spurs Podcast. Fab, mucho gracias, mi amigo.
Thank you. Gracias. Saludos a todos. Yes.
We'll see you next time on Sound of Spurs Podcast.